Swamiji. And all along the trip, she kept on pestering Swamiji. You can heal people. I am also interested. Teach me how to heal people. And Swamiji told her, see, I can heal people because that's there in my bio memory. But the science of allowing other people to heal, that's a science on its own. And that is not yet known to me. I can download it, but it's not yet available for me, is what Swamiji told her. But she didn't leave him. She kept on asking him, please tell me how to do it. You can do it. What way is it useful? I should also learn to do it. I am your disciple. How can you not teach me? When you know how to do it, I am your disciple. I should also know. Like this, she kept on nagging him. Tell me, tell me, tell me, like that. Then when they reached the samadhi, and they were both there in front of the master's samadhi in that shrine, once again she started. See, you diverted the topic. You're not teaching me how to do it. I know you can tell me how to do it, and all these things. So suddenly, as Swamiji was connecting with the energy of the master there, suddenly Swamiji had a vision of the master. So the master was there, and Swamiji was like directly communicating with that master. He was there in the presence of Sadashiva Brahmendra, and Swamiji very casually told him, see how she's nagging me? Continuously, since morning she's on my head to, you know, teach her the science of healing. What do I do? He asked the master. Who? Swamiji. Obviously, this lady didn't have the darshan or the vision, but Swamiji was directly communicating. He had the darshan, the vision of the master. Then suddenly, as Swamiji was connecting with the master's energy, there was a thin grass, you know, a blade of grass. A durva grass blade was there. Small, thin grass, one piece of it. The master, Sadashiv Brahmendra, just handed over that grass to Swamiji's hand. And as that grass got transferred into Swamiji's hand, the whole science of initiating another person into healing, which is the science of opening up the Anandaganda chakra, just got downloaded into Swamiji's biomemory. Just inside of that one thing. Now this lady was there, she didn't see the master, but she could see the grass getting into Swamiji's hands. And she was shocked. She was like there looking what's happening. And as soon as the grass came into his hands, the entire science got revealed. And Swamiji just took one piece out of it, small piece, gave it to her and said, now you start healing people. That's how the first person got initiated into healing. In the very presence of Sadashiva Brahmendra's Jiva Samadhi. She was the first healer that we had. And now we have over 5,000 healers across the world. We've done hundreds of programs Swamiji has done where he has initiated people into the science of spiritual healing. And healing is one dimension of the mission where we don't charge anything. We have gone to hundreds and thousands of people. We have reached out through healing. Hundreds and thousands of people have been cured. Really from fatal diseases like coma and, you know, being on the ventilator to chronic illnesses from cancers to many, many diseases get healed when our healers go and heal people. I know a lot of us ourselves have had healing miracles. How many of you have experienced healing? For whichever, for any condition you've had when another person has given you healing or you have healed yourself. So you can see a lot of people, we ourselves, it's a daily thing for us where we heal ourselves, we heal others, and lot of hospital visits go down actually just because of the power of healing. So this lady was the first person to receive the, you know, the grass and the initiation from Swamiji. And after that, Swamiji started initiating people into being healers. When we first came to this place, to the Bididi ashram, the whole ashram was a barren land. It was actually a snake farm. And though they evacuated most of the snakes, around 3,000 snakes were still there around. It was a forest. This whole entire premises, the whole campus area is like around 44 acres. So across the 44 acres, they were just huge and, you know, all rocks and boulders. It was like a literally no life place. All weeds, snakes, and nearby there was some forest where, you know, elephants and tigers and other animals would use this as their regular path to move up and down that forest. So literally it was a place which cannot be inhabited by human beings. And this land was donated by someone to Swamiji. Interestingly, they had a dream. They had a dream where their family deity, a goddess who was their family deity, continuously appeared in their dream telling them that they have to donate this land to its owner. Telling them for generations they were keeping this land just to give it back to Nityananda. Now they didn't even know who Swamiji was. They went searching for him and they found him. And they said, we are getting continuously dreams from our Kula Devata, our family deity, that we got to give this to you. So we are here, please accept this. And Swamiji refused it. Swamiji will never ever go with what people do or say. He looks at something else always. So he said, no, it's okay, you keep it. We'll see after some more days. You go back now, think about it. Think another 10 times. It's not a small decision. He told all this and he sent them away. Another week, 10 days went by and continuously they were only getting vision of the family deity all over the place. Each time she's telling them, go give now. So they again come back and again ask and finally they've donated the land. So when Swamiji stepped into this land, there were few people with him at that time, few of the people who were ashram residents, the ashramites, they were shocked seeing this land. What can you do with such a land? Completely, no trees, no life, just dry, barren land. And Swamiji just said, wait and watch. In 6 months, this will be an international ashram. And there was no water. They had water problem also. One day Swamiji went with his walking stick and he started tapping. Here you dig, here you dig, here you, just with the walking stick. Everywhere he placed the stick, water came. And within 6 months, big trees came up. The whole thing became green, just like as in a movie they show, like that. And 6 months from that day, the first international ashramites happened in the ashram. From the US, a family came, they left everything there and they came and they started living with Swamiji. Program started and everything started up. There's one bit in this ashram where a lot of trees, which were the old bamboo trees, and it's all dead. It was a dead land, and people who were with Swamiji said, let's clear off this. All these bamboo trees are of no use. They're all dry and, we're going to clear this whole thing. We can construct some building here or make something here. Swamiji said, no. Don't touch a single tree in this particular area. And that grass which Sadashiva Brahmendra gave him, remember, he gave him one grass blade, out of which one small portion he gave to that lady. The rest of it, Swamiji planted in that particular part of the land. And within a month, all the bamboo trees became green. Just a month, with just one blade of grass that he planted, the entire, and that is still one of my most favorite spots in the ashram. Unfortunately, it's interior, so you guys can't go in because only ashramites can go to that place. But still, that's one of the best spots in the ashram for me. Though now I hardly get time. Outside the hall, I hardly live, by the way. My life is inside the hall all the time because some program or the other is always happening. But in the days when I had a chance to be there, after the banyan tree, that place I really enjoy. Such a green, you just stand under it, you can experience the entire energy. So much of healing energy is there. And all the bamboo trees came up with life. And even today, you will be given healer sticks. You'll be given a stick for healing. All the healing sticks come from that particular bamboo grove only. Swamiji calls it the Siddhavana. From that particular small garden, all the healers' initiation sticks, all the sticks which our healers use, they're supplied from there. So even now, it is there in the ashram, and we have our bamboo sticks that we give, actually, which Swamiji energizes. It comes from there. So like this, the science where another person can become a healer, where just with one touch, Swamiji can transmit the whole science, he can insert it, and he can awaken your Anandaganda, got available with that situation, with that incident that happened. And after that, thousands and thousands of people have been initiated as healers. When you do the traditional medicine, you get expertise in being a doctor with one field. But when you are a Nitya spiritual healer, you're literally like a specialist. You can be there and heal any and every disease related to any body part. Literally, it's like specialization into all body parts. The functioning of all body parts, that's what will be available for you. But that said, there are a few do's, there are a few don'ts, there are certain rules, and there are many things which we will talk between now and tomorrow.
When you say that we can heal everything, wouldn't it be more precise to say that we can heal certain type of ailment?
No, you can heal everything.
No, tu peux tout guérir.
We'll look at that. We'll see what all, how you'll be able to heal anything and everything you can heal. So, there are a few do's and don'ts that we'll look at before we get ready for getting the initiation. The first thing is that whomever you're healing, you're only going to call them as a participant. You will not call them as a patient because you are not a doctor. You're a healer. So Dr. Karthik will not lose his job because you're not going to be conferred with a title called doctor. Even I'm saying in the same light. Only be conferred with, you're a healer. And you are a Nitya spiritual healer. That's what you will be called. And the healing itself will be called as Nitya spiritual healing service. It's not about any kind of medication or treatment or a clinic or no. Nitya spiritual healing service. That's what it will be called. Clear? So the first thing is, it's a spiritual healing service prayer. Sorry, Nitya spiritual healing service prayer. So it's literally like you're meditating and praying for someone. It's like that. And you will be called a healer. So you will not be putting a title of doctor in front of your name because you're not conferred with that title. That's the first thing. Now, because you are not a doctor, the person comes to you is not a patient. They are called the participant. So you cannot refer to them as a patient. Clear? That's the first thing. Second, in all the countries where there may be legal rules for touching someone and for doing services like healing, you'll have to take the consent form. I don't think all countries will need it. There may be some rare countries like maybe some in the UAE, like Sharjah or Dubai, even those, not all of them have, but some places will have. So if you have a doubt, please refer to the nearest center, nearest Nityananda center or Vedic temple, and they'll be able to guide you. For most of us in this room, it's not needed. But wherever it is needed, please ensure you fill in the consent form before you go ahead and heal the person. Clear? And you will not replace a doctor's role in the person's life because you are not a doctor. So you will not say, oh, you can stop using these medicines, or you stop doing this, stop doing that. That's none of our business. We will not comment on their medical history, the medications they take, and the practices prescribed to them by their doctor. Even if they feel they've been healed and they think that everything is fine, and they ask you for advice, should I stop the medicine? You're not authorized to make any changes to their medication. Either decreasing a dosage or saying, oh, no need, you can stop the medicine now. No, you will not do any of that. Are you guys clear? Because you're going to sign forms now stating that you will not be doing such things. And if you do such thing and somebody sues you are only liable. Nityananda Dhyanapitam is not responsible in any way because we are not asking you to do that with people. We are only saying this is a very beautiful meditation prayer service. Are you guys getting this? So you will not give any medical advices, any counseling related to medicine, related to what they should do or they should not do. If anyone has such a question, please direct them to their personal physician, to their doctor. Ask them to consult their doctor and then take a call. Tell them you are not in a position, neither are you authorized to guide them and advise them about medication or any other alternative medical treatment that they are going through. Clear? So when anyone asks you, please ask them to consult a doctor. Ask them to go to their own doctor and take a call, and you will not in any way influence the way they take medication in their life. You are not authorized to do that, so you will not do that. Okay? Yes.
Will the more we meditate and participate as we grow with Swamiji, will our healing abilities become, our Swamiji's healing abilities, will the ability for his energy to express through us become greater? Does that have a, like, so if I heal someone now when I get out, will it, can it improve as my connection to him improves?
There's nothing called improve or de-improve in this. It's very absolute in nature. When you are a conductor conducting healing, you're not even there, you're just empty. But your body's capacity to hold and transmit the energy will go up.
That's what I mean.
That will be there, but that doesn't in any way impact the healing that can happen. More and more can express through you. But it also depends, the actual healing itself is also depending on the person who's receiving the healing. That is always there, which additionally contributes to the healing.
So the only thing that can improve is me getting in the way.
Is you?
Is me, like when I'm performing the healing, I can only become more unclutched as I grow.
Yeah, so is you getting out of the way?
Yeah, I'll get better at getting out of the way.
Yeah.
Okay.
So far with me? So one, you will not call the person as patient. You will call the person always, the person who is receiving healing as participant. You will always take their agreement before you do this. We cannot go and force healing on anyone. They have to be a request for us to heal them. Is this clear? Yeah. That said, if somebody is like not in a position to talk, obviously you won't force them to talk, right? You can't wait and say, okay, now you're not giving me your consent, you will die. People with them, like their family or friends or whoever is taking care of them, if they request healing, you can still heal them. If the participant himself or herself is not in conscious awareness, people attending to them can request you to heal them and you can still heal them. Clear? So always you will heal people who are a request for you to heal them. You will always call them as participants and not as patients. You will never give them any personal counseling or advice about their medication, about their lifestyle or any of it which is related to their medical condition. You will not give any kind of direct or indirect medical advice. You cannot be a substitute for their doctor. You will have to guide them to meet their doctor if they want to know what to do with their medicines. They can go for the check. You know, their doctor can decide for them. Is this clear? That said, when you're healing someone, you can always share with them about the Kriyas. Do you guys know Swamiji has given 108 Kriyas already related to physical medical disorders? Do we know this?
Yes.
108 are already there. It's free, available in the website. You can direct people to the website. There are actually videos, free videos in YouTube, where Swamiji himself is guiding the person through the Kriya. You can open up that link and have people practice Kriyas. We have Kriyas for various ailments like migraine, diabetes, arthritis, blood pressure, heart condition, stress, depression. Like this, for so many variety of medical disorders, Swamiji has already given 108 techniques, which are simple Kriyas, you know, which is simple pranayama, simple asanas, simple stretching, sitting in particular postures, breathing in particular way, very simple things which people can do sitting in their house without having to come anywhere, and they see huge results. That you can suggest, but you cannot suggest, you know, you stop doing, taking this medicine or don't eat this. None of that. We'll not do any of that. Are you with me so far? Is it clear?
Yes.
Yes? Then, when you are getting initiated to being a healer. Actually, before we get to that point, there are two categories of healing healers who are available. There are two types of healing. One healing which is known as the self-healing. Self-healing is where I heal myself. All self-healers will have the initiation into healing themselves, meaning the boundary of yourself is your skin. Outside your skin, you cannot heal anything. You will have to strictly be healing yourself inside you. Means you are the boundary. You cannot heal any person, any animate, inanimate thing outside you when you are taking self-healer's initiation. Are you guys clear?
Yes.
This is self-healing. Now there is another initiation where you are taking initiation to heal others. Initiation to heal others is when I am ready to heal another person along with myself. So by default, the whole class will be a self-healer. Additionally, some of you, if you want, you can choose to heal others. Goes without saying, healing others is a much more powerful space to be in than being a self-healer. Because anyways, it contains self-healer also. Then what is the difference between two that differentiates these two things? So please listen carefully, especially if you're taking initiation for the first time. You have to really get the ground rules correct. So please listen up. If you are choosing to heal another person, when I say healing others, I mean healing everything. You can heal yourself and things outside of you. So I can, for example, if I'm healing others, I can heal the water bottle, the laptop, the fan, other human beings, the dogs, cats, trees, everything. Wherever I touch and get into the healing meditation, I'll be able to heal. That is a person who can heal others. Now there are certain rules for you to be eligible to heal others. What are the rules? Number one, you cannot drink, touch, inhale alcohol anymore. You'll have to go off all kinds of alcohols. You'll have to stop eating non-vegetarian food and you'll have to stop smoking and usage of drugs of any kind. This is a commitment you have to mandatorily follow if you are choosing to heal others. Now if some of your responses are, oh God, I cannot do this, it is not compulsory to heal others. You can choose to be a self-healer, healing the own boundary of your body and be happy with it. Still your Anandaganda will be open, by the way. The Anandaganda chakra itself is open, but the energy, the level up to which it can work on you, definitely will be much higher when you're healing others. Nothing can be done for that. But in order to do that, you will have to be a strong commitment. A commitment to sticking to the ground rules of being a person healing others. And what is that commitment once again? Once the initiation is done, for the rest of your life after that, you are committing that you will not touch alcohol of any kind. So whether it is wine, beer, whiskey, Shiva's Regal, brandy, champagne, vodka, rum, gin, whatever. Any and every kind of alcohol which I have named and not named. In one class like this, I told all these. And I didn't mention one. And that person thought that's an exception. One old man who was there. He stood up and he said, and he's from Andhra, by the way. So that means I can have kallu. Kallu thagachamma. Kallu means village toddy. I said, no! No kallu. You can't drink even kallu. Kallu is village toddy, by the way. And they say that it gives a lot of that. It's very raw and that kick it gives. You know, kallu thagachsa. He got, oh, so that means I can drink toddy. No, you can't. Your village arak, any other thing which you know, they said, oh, wine is grape juice. Then drink grape juice, don't drink wine. So no wine. If you want grape juice, please drink grape juice. There are lots of grape juices available in the market. So any kind of alcohol, of any form, okay, whether it's grape extract, root extract, seed extract, this extract, that is, however it is made. Alcohol means strictly capital letter no. For any occasion, oh my father died, I have only one father who will die only once. No. No, stop and ask this question. That's why I bring up all these questions. Only once a year I have Christmas mass. No. Only once a year in the church they give me this, you know, they give the, like some prasada they give. No. No. Irrespective of what it is, you cannot drink. It's not even based on any occasion, there is an exception. You cannot. You just cannot touch alcohol anymore. and it is not moral science. Very clearly Swamiji has specified, it is not about that, oh, it is good not to drink, drinking is a bad habit, not at all from the moral point of view which society teaches you. It is from an energy point of view. Alcohol is a very low energy substance. Do you guys agree that everything is energy? Do you guys agree that camera has its own energy frequency, that mic has its own energy, the TV has its own energy? Of course, you and me have our own energy frequency. Anyway, so every single thing that is there, whether it is alive or not alive, has energy, isn't it? So the energy of alcohol as a substance, as an element, is very low. And when you especially are healing others, your kundalini energy is shooting up to its peak. When these both meet, the clash and conflict that happens results in disease. For whom? You, not the person who is receiving healing. They'll be fine. You will start falling ill. And you'll wonder, oh God, what is happening? But that is because of this. Because of a conflict in the energy that's happening inside you. Alcohol, tobacco, drugs are very, very low in energy. And they are contradiction to your kundalini energy rising up inside you. Are you guys getting this? And especially when you are healing another person, the kundalini awakening in you is very high compared to when you are healing yourself. So that and this will contradict each other. That is why no alcohol. Not because what society moral science book teaches. Brush your teeth every day, you are a good boy, comb your hair, do not drink alcohol, alcohol and smoking is bad. Not like that. Not like a moral science lesson. But from an energy perspective, these substances contain very, very low energy. So it is not at all good for your system. Clear so far? Don't ask me questions, we'll wait for questions. So alcohol of all kinds, except medicines. Earlier Swamiji had mentioned somewhere, right? Your cough syrups have slight alcohol content in them. If your doctor has prescribed some medicine which may have alcohol content or animal products, do you know there are some disorders which need you to take medicines which have maybe fish oil and some other things like that? That is okay and fine. But that said, you are desperately missing alcohol, you go and gulp down 10 cough syrups. No. You cannot do that. Obviously, you have to be authentic. I'm so, oh, they say, what is that? My mouth is dry, I want. No, anyway, medicine is fine, he said, and you'll bring some 10 cough syrups, pour it in a glass and drink it. No, not like that. Only the 2 ml which the doctor suggests, or 5 ml or 10 ml. That too, if you have cough, you don't have cough, but you want a kick of alcohol, you can't take it. You have to be authentic with it, na? Is this clear? So any medicines are okay. If you are on a doctor prescribed medication, it is okay. However, if it is a health supplement, you have to immediately replace it with organic health supplements. There are a lot of people who take that what oil? Cod liver oil, fish liver oil, or you know, some kind of products which apparently boost the immunity, and you know, they are like that, health supplements. Means they are not like mandatory for you, for any disease or disorder you have. It's generally good for you. Those you can't have. You'll have to switch to organic health supplements. There are so many organic health supplements which are there almost for everything, for your immunity, for your bones, for your heart, for everything. So you can switch to the organic health supplements. But if it is the main medicine which is for one of the diseases you're having or a disorder you're having, for example, some kinds of cancer have morphine. You know, they use that drug. Is it morphine or whatever, some drug, which is otherwise considered a narcotic drug. So if it is for a health purpose, using that as a medicine, as a drug for your health condition is allowed. If not, you cannot use it. Is this clear so far? So all kinds of alcohols. Next, all kinds of cigarettes. Whether it's a big cigar, whether it's a cigarette, what is that? Sniffing, God knows all kinds of things. Sniffing, then tasting, putting on your tongue and licking it, smelling it, taking it into like injections, all kinds. BD, BDs, Don't think it's an exception. I know from the toddy I learned the BD also. How your village toddy is not allowed, village BD is also not allowed. You know there are BDs where they just roll it in something and they chew it and eat it. And chewable, eatable, inhalable, in any kind of able. It cannot get into you. Clear? You cannot consume tobaccos of any kind in any form. Okay? Neither orally nor by smoking. Because somebody actually asked, I won't allow it to get into my lungs. Only something through the mouth or through the nose I'll take. Nothing. You can't touch it. You cannot do that. Number one. Number two, somebody asked, oh, if I'm in a smoking zone and others are smoking and then automatically it gets into my nose, don't be in a smoking zone. Why will you be in a smoking zone? You can avoid being there, no? You can tell them that I don't smoke. Who will force you? Somebody is tying you and putting you there or what? You don't need to be there. Correct? So, you will avoid inhaling and consuming tobaccos of all kinds, in all forms. And there is no exception to this because there is no medicine which will say take this much of tobacco for some condition. So, that is not even there in this. What? Huh? Beeda na? Ah, BD, I told no. BD, that also. Pan? Who's asking for pan? So, in panaya, there is something called, I don't know if it's zarda or something else, which has some kind of intoxicant. I was searching for that word. You cannot use that. You understand? There are different types of pans that actually are depends upon what they are putting when they make the pan. The leaf is fine. Pan is the beetle leaf is fine. No problem with the leaf. No problem with even the, what is that? Okkapadu nevantaru? The powder, the beetle nut powder, right? Beetle nut powder, that is the supari powder, beetle leaf is fine. But your pan parag, zarda, what are other kinds? All those, there are some other categories. Brothers and sisters of zarda, all that is considered like gutka. Gutka. Those are things which kind of have drug kind of substances in them. Not at all okay. You have to completely stop those. The normal sada pan is fine. Safest is just the leaf. That is fine. But any other things you are mixing, you have to be careful what they are mixing and you cannot use those. Because they are on borderline of being intoxicants which are kind of drugs. Clear? Clear about the cigarette and cigars and smoking and tobacco part? In any form, you cannot use it. The next is the most hot subject now, non-vegetarian food. Oh, here we are opening up a huge can of 1000 questions will come now. Before you pounce to the mic, I tell you, listening is so important here. You'll have to listen. I know just with one session like this, 1 kg of my weight goes down. Because people just don't listen and I again and again repeat the same things. And additionally, somebody went and asked in Darshan, they asked Swamiji. And Swamiji said, Manisha, did you not tell anything? I said, Swamiji, 2 full days I told only that. But anyway, if you didn't listen, that means I didn't tell. That's how I live life. So I want to be very clear. I will tell it again and again. I'm requesting your listening. You have to grace me with your listening. Really. Okay? So non-vegetarian food. What is non-vegetarian food? Everything that crawls, flies, walks, talks on 2 leg, 3 leg, 8 leg, 5 leg, 1 leg, everything is non-vegetarian. Everything that moves basically is non-vegetarian food. You cannot come and tell me I'm a Bengali Brahmin, fish is vegetarian. No, it is not. For you it is. But for Nitya spiritual healing service, fish is something which walks, moves, non-vegetarian. Simple scale for what is non-vegetarian, everything that moves in some form, including a snail, you will say it hardly moves. Once in an hour it moves one inch, still non-vegetarian, good enough. So non-vegetarian food of any kind is, I'll come to that. I know that's a most favorite subject, I'll come to that. So non-vegetarian food of any kind which is non-vegetarian in nature, I'll talk about that, is strictly prohibited. Egg is also non-vegetarian. Again, it is not, how many, nothing can be done. It's not from a moral science point of view. It is not because killing animals is bad, killing animals is cruel and karma, it is not because of that. It is not that at all. It is because of energy conflict. When you kill non-vegetarian, when you eat, it's a life form whose consciousness, whose energy is there with life. And that is contradictory for your system. Why? Because, for example, usually that's what they do, no, in the whatever, those mutton shops and all that. What they do, and this is one subject which I just, the thought of it, I used to literally feel like vomiting. Now I'm kind of, because I've been so strictly born and brought up, we hardly had even onions in our life. I told you I'm from such an orthodox family, onion, garlic, they wouldn't cook. Only after we came into a nuclear family, my mother started cooking onion, garlic. But otherwise, till then, unheard of, like that kind of family. Anyway, so non-vegetarian food, especially when the animal is taken and, you know, the meat is being taken out, at the point when it is dying, the animal will leave all its adrenaline, you know, it has its own fear mechanism, right? Its fear, its dissatisfaction and anxiety, the animal's blood and hormones will release it at the time of its death. Now, when you consume that meat, all of that gets transmitted into your blood supply. You understand what I'm saying? And that results in violence, that results in deep anxiety and distress inside you. It is very, very, very harmful for the body. It's not that you'll allow a sheep to meditate, die with a cardiac arrest or natural death, and then the butcher will cut it and give it to you. No butcher in the world will wait for a peaceful, natural death to happen to a sheep, no. For a sheep or a goat or whatever you replace there. All animals are just killed, that's all. And the point of dying, all animals will have that, you know, that, what do you call? Tadapna, what is that called in English? Whatever, that, you know, that restlessness, that, obviously life is going out of its system. Correct? So that will impact you, and the way you will live your life is heavily impacted. Non-vegetarians therefore have a more highly, you know, the restlessness, the anxiety, the panic attacks are much more higher in your system when you eat non-veg to when you eat vegetarian food. More than all that, as Nitya spiritual healer, if you are choosing to heal another person, your Kundalini energy is at a completely different level, which will be contradicted by the energy that happens through non-vegetarian food. Non-vegetarian food is very, very, very low energy. It's on a negative scale. Are you guys getting this? Now somebody asked us, what about plants? Plants also are living beings. They are. But the conscious life in a plant is much lower than the conscious life in an animal. That is why plants are okay. Mushrooms are also considered non-vegetarian food. Mushrooms and seaweeds are also considered non-vegetarian food. There are very few organic seaweeds which are passed by Swamiji. So I would say avoid all seaweeds. We've had participants in the past who would send me courier, you know. Once I received a big courier packet from somebody in Malaysia, some devotee, some Chinese devotee. I was wondering, how come I got a, you know, parcel that to courier? I opened and this many, some 20 to 50 items were there, small, some grass, some yellow color, blue color, different food items. All the 50 Swamiji rejected as no. Poor thing, she must have been disappointed. I wrote back to her saying, Ma, no, you can't use any of this. So most of the seaweeds and all that are also considered non-vegetarian, and you cannot have them if you are choosing to heal others. Because it impacts, it imbalances your Kundalini energy inside your system. Egg is also not allowed. Why? Because the possibility for life happening in an egg is high. So egg therefore is considered like a life form only. When somebody actually asked this, Swamiji very jokingly told in one of the healers initiation sessions, they asked, how come you are saying egg is not allowed? Egg is given by hen. Milk is given by cow. Milk you can drink, egg you can't eat. Why? Then Swamiji said in a joking way, if hen sits on egg, chicken will come out, chick will come out, no? If cow sits on milk, will calf come out? Swamiji actually asked the person, if a cow sits on milk, will the calf come out? No, but when hen sits on egg, hen will come out. Then he explained this whole science of why energy wise, you know, egg has a very high life energy inside it. So egg is not allowed. Then we have intelligent people. What about egg which is what? Sterile egg or something, some machine egg? No. Even that is not allowed. What about duck egg? Duck egg, ostrich egg, nightingale egg, cuckoo egg, crow egg, snake egg, lizard egg, hen egg. Any and every species on the planet which gives eggs, no egg is allowed. Be very clear, whether it's an ostrich, a hen, a snake, don't bother. Egg is zero. You cannot have egg. Okay? No, it's not that. Unfertile egg? No, fertile, unfertile, nothing. Any category of egg, egg is egg. You cannot have egg. Simple. Somebody asked, no, I won't touch the yellow. Can I touch the white? No, you can't touch the white. No, really people have asked these questions. You cannot have yellow aside and just the white I'll have. No. Egg white, egg yellow, egg shell, everything about the egg you cannot touch and eat and drink. Okay, egg in the form of omelette, egg in the form of boiled egg, egg in the scrambled egg, half egg, full egg, any egg, not allowed. Any form, it is not allowed. Is that clear? In any way, it is not allowed. And somebody asked, we make chicken curry, can I have the gravy and not the piece? Of course you can't have the gravy. No. No, people have really asked these, I'm telling you. Can I have a clear chicken soup? No. Clear soup, unclear soup, semi-clear soup, no soup which has chicken can you have. Irrespective of whether the chicken material is there in it or not there in it, you cannot have it. Even gravy you cannot have because it disbalances the energy inside your body. I'm telling you, if you have and you heal others, you will start getting skin diseases. This is pretty serious. So please, though we are joking about it, be very clear you are committed to not eating it. You can, it can end up in skin rash and itching and all kinds of discomfort for you. And I don't think you want skin rashes and itches in the wrong places. Where you go, don't even have the freedom to itch. It'll be like that. You can imagine what I'm saying. It's one of the most biggest punishments we can get. You get skin rash and itch in a spot where you can't even itch. You'll have to keep running to the bathroom for that. Don't get into that. Is this clear? So you cannot have egg, mushrooms, seaweeds and every other chicken, mutton, beef, pork, any of that. I don't even know the spellings of half of them. Any fish, prawn, scorpion, rabbit, whatever, tiger, whatever it is that you can consider eating, nothing you can eat. Everything is under the non-vegetarian bracket. Then, you cannot have it even in the form of chocolates. Do you know there are many chocolates which are non-vegetarian in nature? There are chocolates which contain animal product. They will have the red mark on them. The wrappers will have red and green. Many chocolates have that. Now, some people ask, oh, if they don't have red and green, what do I do? Check for the ingredients. Ingredients will say animal fat, bone fat or bone marrow, they'll actually mention. If it is not mentioned, what do I do? Don't eat. Simple. It's not that you will not live without eating chocolates. Come on. Don't eat. And I can tell you there are thousands of varieties of food you can eat, yeah. Vegetarian has thousands of varieties. Everything that is served in the ashram you can eat. Before you come up and ask one person, can I drink water? Can I drink milk? Can I drink? You'll begin from there. Everything that is being served in this hall can be eaten and drunk. So ask yourself before you ask me, can I eat this? Is it being served on the counter here? You can eat that, you can drink that. So curd is fine, milk is fine. The organic cheese, we do serve cheese and butter here. If it is organic, it is fine. Jaggery is fine, all the sweets are fine, everything which we serve basically is okay to eat. And you see in the last few days you didn't even have one single onion in the food. Wasn't the food tasty? Tell me. It's not because I'm asking. If you didn't like it, you should tell you didn't like it. But how many of you know, you agree that the food is tasty in the ashram? And it is a completely vegetarian food. Totally vegetarian, no onion, no garlic, no green chilies. I know, it's really good. I enjoy the food as well. And nothing. Why no chili? Is that what the question is? Again, there are three things, okay? Chili, onion and garlic are, please listen, I will not have any one of you ask me about this. Chili, onion, green chili, sorry, green chili, onion, garlic and sugar are good to avoid. What are they? Good to avoid, not mandatory. Clear? Means you can eat them. It's not mandatory. It's not like non-vegetarian which you cannot eat. Clear? Why? Because onion, garlic and green chili, Swamiji says, is steroids. Only if you have a medical condition, you're supposed to eat them. You understand this? If you're taking tablets, for example, you don't have migraine. Will you take migraine tablet? You won't. Why will you take? Onion also is like that. If you don't have those special medical disorders, you should not be taking onion. Same with green chili, same with garlic. Garlic is very good for heart conditions and all. If you have, you have to take it because it's a medicine. If you don't have, you should not take. Because it is tasty, you should not take it. But it is only good to avoid. I'm telling it another time. These are only good to avoid, not mandatory. Nobody will come to the mic and ask me this question. It's okay if I eat onion? Is it okay if I eat garlic, green chili, sugar? It is okay. But Swamiji recommends that you avoid it. So you can choose not to eat it. But nothing, the heaven will not fall on your head and your kundalini will not go somewhere if you eat them. Nothing will happen. It's just that Swamiji says, see if you can avoid them. Clear? Clear? Sugar is considered to cause cancer. And Swamiji has directly downloaded this information in one of his samadhis. It got revealed to him. So if you are using sugar, stop it. Whether you are a healer, healing yourself or others, doesn't matter. I'm sure you don't want cancer. So sugar is considered to cause cancer. And the Swamiji has directly shared this. Now if you ask for proof and witness and all, you can wait for the end of your life. It will happen if it has to happen. But really Swamiji has said this. And in the ashram you're eating sweets, no? Aren't they good? We don't use sugar at all in anything. And we are serving you breads, we are serving you cookies, we are serving you all kinds of sweets made out of jaggery. They're all pretty tasty, no? And you'll get used to it, yeah. Few days if you don't eat, you will not even know the difference. Is this clear so far? So, chocolates, cakes, direct food, soups, drinks, anything which has any kind of alcohol, animal fat, tobacco, you cannot consume. So your Christmas cake, the plum cake, rum cake, this cake, all that has no rum and all that, you can't take that. You can't take small piece for courtesy. For courtesy also small piece you can't take. You just can't take it anymore if you're choosing to heal others. Did you get it so far? Yes? So somebody asked if when I'm socializing in parties, can I? No, you can't. Even when you're socializing, when you go out, you can very politely not take that. Somebody asked, are cool drinks okay? Now when I'm not telling about that, don't even ask. Everything else is okay. But one thing, cool drink, Swamiji has always said, can be used as a pesticide. In farms, you know, farmers are using Coke and Thumbs Up nowadays for as pesticides. So if you consider your body as something which needs pesticide and acid, you will take it. But it has got nothing to do with your healing capacity. Wake up, lot of us are sleeping. Wake up, wake up, wake up. Few more minutes, we'll go for the break. Clear? So cool drinks per se are fine. It's not that there is a mandatory no to that. But it's recommended you avoid it if you can. But apart from that, any kind of tobacco, any kind of alcohol, any kind of non-vegetarian food in any form is not allowed. Clear? Then somebody asked, if somebody is drunk, can I give them healing? No. Put them under a tap, do whatever it takes to bring that down, tell them to come in a non-drinking state. You can't heal people who are drunk. Are you clear? Now if they are drunk and they meet with an accident, that's a separate thing. We'll come to that little later. But right now, are you clear with whatever we spoke till now? Yes. This I have not covered. Good question. Can we prepare non-vegetarian food? You can prepare non-vegetarian food. But in the name of preparation, you can't taste it. Usually we do that, na? In between, we'll put, oh, salt is enough? To check the salt I ate, No. You can't taste it. You have to call some other taster because typically we taste the food, no? When we are... So even in the name of taste, that small drop which you lick from your hand, you can't do that. You can prepare, you can serve. That is fine. And Swamiji once mentioned to someone while preparing, see if you can put a cloth around your nose and mouth. Because intake many a times happens with the nose and mouth. Now just with the smell, you will literally devour the whole food kind of a thing. And then somebody asked, can we cook in the same utensils for us? Now if you are in a most unfortunate situation where you cannot afford another set of utensils for you, obviously you will cook in the same vessels. If not, I would recommend you use different vessels for cooking for you and cooking for the family for whom you are cooking non-vegetarian food. Clear? Clear? So you can cook and serve, but you can't taste. Oh, I'll taste and see how it is. You can't do that because that's again equal to consuming it. Can I touch it? Can I cut the fish with my hand? Of course, with your hand only you'll cut, no? That is fine. But you can't allow it to go in any form. Is that clear? So for cooking, preparing for others is okay. But if you're taking on healing others, you can't consume it in any form. You'll have to be careful. Then people ask, how about when I go outside? You'll have to be very careful when you go outside. You'll have to ask them what they put in it. I've heard in many restaurants, they consider like, you know, the fish, some soups and salads as vegetarian. In many places, the sauces they use, and generally you say vegetarian and sit down, he will nicely serve you crab and go in the name of vegetarian. Only after you eat, you'll know. And he'll say, yeah, crab is vegetarian in this part of the world, he'll tell you. So you'll have to really, really ask him what all he put. If you have a doubt, when in doubt, become a nirahari. Just don't eat anything. Now you know you won't die if you don't eat for 1 day, 2 days, nothing will happen. It's better not to eat when you are in doubt than eat and then again get you have to come back like how Mahinath and Seema are here for that only. Because by mistake they ate something, now they have to come back to another healer's initiation course and get the reinitiation. That is what it is if you eat by mistake, by the way. By mistake without your knowledge, or suddenly one day you just forgot and you ate, you cannot heal others anymore. You can continue healing yourself. There is never a stop for healing yourself. That will never end. That you can continue for the rest of your life. And by the way, if you choose to be a self-healer, you can do everything. You can drown yourself in a barrel of liquor every day. You can take all the drugs available. You can eat all kinds of flying, talking, walking, running, bird, animal, reptile, everything you can do. And you can still heal. But only yourself. You can't even heal a small stone outside of you. Remember, you'll get into serious trouble. But that time you can swim in an ocean of alcohol. You put all, mix everything and just jump into it and dive, no problem. If you are a self-healer, only for that. But if you are healing others, know very clearly the Kundalini energy in you will obviously correspondingly be very high. Very, very high intelligence and energy will be available, but this is the sacrifice you need to do for that. And it's not 1 day, 2 day, for the rest of your life.